And good morning, everyone. So big data is the rage of today. Everybody has been talking about big data, and the scale and the pace at which the data that the various organizations are capturing is actually increasing multifold. And this is one of the key trends, which is basically creating a good confluence between HR technology and the analytical design. When we talk about big data, HR is something which is a new kid in the block as far as the field of big data is concerned. But organizations who have leveraged big data have definitely been able to add tangible value to the organization, and they've been able to see show the top line and the bottom line impacts of this. So the panel today is an esteemed panel. We'll probably start with basically MBS in this particular case by asking MBS to introduce himself and his relationship with HR analytics and HR technology.
Thanks, Neeraj, and fellow panelists, and the team who come taken heart to listen to us today. Thank you very much for being here. Interesting topic, and the introduction talked about me being part of Future Group. So I look after the HR operations for a captive IT, which is called New Future Digital India Limited. And by virtue of being associated with this captive IT for a little over 10 years, I developed the capability, not the competency, capability to understand technology to some extent, and I drive all the employee related solutions within the group. So my first crush with HR analytics happened way back in 2012, and 2012-13 when I actually conceived the idea of starting my research in HR analytics, a very unheard or little known topic probably with amongst the practitioners at that point of time. Took the heart to take the leap, and glad to inform that I successfully completed this JAN and won my my award for the thesis I presented. So dated back to 2012 when I conceived this idea of HR analytics, definitely I think few thoughts which came in my mind was the evolving data at this point of time, and how HR as a fraternity is going to look at this data, and how you help yourself go beyond the typical dashboard and the matrices which we are always used to. So that being the first thought, went into the construct of my work. And so during the conversation today, at some point, or most of the time, I'll make a direct reference to my research, and I will be glad to share some data points which I captured during the journey. And then as a part of the, Neeraj is going to grill us at towards the end probably, and as a part of my response probably I could share some of my first hand experiences at the organization. That's it from me for now.
Right. Thank you, MS. Arjun, do you want to introduce yourself and your association with big data and HR technology?
Sure. So I'm the founder and CEO of a company called Edge Networks, which is an HR technology platform. So we optimize internal workforces for companies like Wipro and HCL, and we also do the talent acquisition. And it's an AI-driven model, sort of data science-driven, where we sort of use a lot of machine learning, and then we build the power of inference over it. So analysis and analytics is a byproduct of that. It's just a simple fact of our lives. And I don't come from an HR background, so I've sort of been on the hiring end of things at one level and sort of seen the problem as a global problem. But interesting to see that I think the concept of big data is something that we want to talk about today and then drive into analytics and why it's valuable. But I think today, at least for the audience, we're going to rest the idea of big data to one solid fact. It does exist, and it is something that we as a community need to address as a problem that gives us a great opportunity, right, to look at different facets of information. In fact, we were presenting at we had a booth at the NVIDIA Global Technology Conference in 2017 as one of the NVIDIA Inception program winners. And how Google founders there, because they were walking through and looking at all the AR and VR companies, and they saw this HR tech company sitting there, and they said, you know, what are you guys doing here? Do you use GPUs to sort of process? And so, of course, if we're here, we use GPUs, and we do deep learning, right? But the fact is, it's not a present thought even for Google to sort of understand, although they sort of process so much information, even on the job side. But you know, I think that's the reality of it. We have to build our deep learning models. We have to build our machine learning models on volumes of data. And enterprise quality data is really where we spend most of our time, because we see so much valid information. As much as we diss data integrity and data quality across the enterprise, I think it's a wealth of information. So one is big data is here, right? And we do analyze it. And the second is analysis or analytics is just another way of life that gives us more insight to make decisions better for all fronts. So that's me.
I will now move to Siddharth. I think his firm is doing quite a lot of work on the productivity side of employees. So we'll like him to talk more about that.
Thanks, Neeraj. Amazing panelist. Really happy to be here. I represent a company called Blue Dolphin, and we found our way sort of in a meandering fashion, but we've always we've been about data. We started out helping firms capture data for field employees, and along the way I realized that, you know, building custom solutions was actually taking away from the core thing that we wanted to do, which is basically help collect, manage, present and help organizations, you know, get actionable intelligence from data. And primarily today, what we're doing is we're generating three different types of data. There's what we like to call presence data. Presence data is really, if you attended my tech talk yesterday, I talked about perseverance and how it actually is an important predictor to success. You've heard this, this type of idiom many times. You know, showing up is half the fight, right? I mean, everyone's talked about how being in the office, just being present, is actually half the battle won. We are trying to basically create a system where capturing and measuring this data, and of course we all know you can only improve what you can measure. So first you have to start measuring. If you think you have a problem, you need to start measuring it first. So what I'm saying in a very roundabout way is big data is here, as he's said, as we've all said, it's not going away. It's the big elephant in the room, and you need to start, you know, taking the, again to mix metaphors, take the elephant by the tusks or the bull by the horn and do stuff with it. Just a few small points to that. My own experience is, you know, enterprises have been capturing data for a long time, but then they warehouse it. It's sitting in SQL servers someday, lying untapped, unused. And a lot of the things that are happening around in the startup ecosystem today is about unlocking that information. So forget social data. I mean, enterprises have had data for 20 years, perhaps longer. You know, it was registers at some point. It became magnetic tapes in the 80s. It became SQL server databases in the 90s and 2000s. It maybe have gone into a MongoDB or NoSQL databases with Cassandra queries, and, you know, we're getting into GPU processing, which is a really key point here. I mean, analytics firms are consuming more GPU processors than anybody else, you know. I mean, NVIDIA has become a billion-dollar company for this reason. But just to come back, big data is here to stay. And I think we are trying to unlock that potential, and we're only just scratching the surface.
Right, absolutely. To quickly introduce myself, I'm Neeraj Tandon, and I lead the practice of workforce analytics and planning for Willis Towers Watson. My association with HR analytics actually dates back to 2010, when I started my first engagement in HR analytics after having done CRM analytics for around 7 years for WNS. But in 2010, I basically started doing HR analytics with HSBC in Hyderabad. And I can tell you the level of analytics that we used to do at that point of time was just to track one metric, which was basically measuring the HR productivity ratio. So HR, number of HR FTEs to the number of business FTEs. But over a period of time, my association with HR analytics actually has grown. And I have actually worked on this particular area for multiple organizations, including Accenture, including Ericsson, and now Willis Towers Watson. What I've seen over a period of time is that the HR analytics as an area has evolved from simply measuring metrics, as what MVS was talking about, and creating simple dashboards, to effectively leverage data from multiple data sources to predict what is likely to happen in the future. So something which purely used to focus on HR effectiveness is now basically translating into providing insights on how we can actually improve the employee experience in an organization. And that is where the HR analytics as an area is heading. And the advent of big data and the technology is actually helping organizations to take more effective decisions on the people side, and thus basically making the overall experience for the employees more, I would say, happier to be in an organization. I'd like to basically start this entire conversation with a question around big data. So we've been talking about big data, but the debate that we normally see, and a lot of people basically say, that HR data is not big data. Now, what I'd like to basically ask panelists in this particular case is, what are your thoughts? Do you think HR data is big data? In my past experience, I've carried HR data in a pen stick. So by no means I can say HR data is big data. But what I know is, over the last few years, technology has evolved. And we'd love to hear from panelists on what are their views on whether HR data is big data or not. MBS.
So I think my vote would be for the HR data is a big data by itself. I'll tell you where I'm coming from. If you look at the definition of big data per se, it's about what kind of a complexity in terms of the data flow. Second is diversity in terms of which sources it comes from. And the third would be is if you can add some elements of business data into it, relevant business data into it, I think collectively it can form to be a big data by itself. Because HR analytics, you're not just going to do with the HR data, the people data by itself. Unless and until you don't marry it with the business data at some point, you will not get a benchmark and a relevance to it. So I think that's my take about you know, how I see HR data is definitely as a big data. And as Gartner also very nicely mentioned about initially the three V's and later to the fourth V, in terms of it's not just the variety, it's not just the value, it is volume and the variance it can bring in, you know, whereas the velocity of the data. So I think you have all of it coming into the HR data these days.
And what we recently see is actually the visualization being added to it. And I think HR fraternity has been quite effectively using visualization to depict the right kind of matrices in this particular case.
If you actually allow me, I think that's the last point which I wanted to capture. I think I can dwell upon it after this questions from the fellow panelists are done. For the big data per se, then maybe I can dwell upon it.
Arjun, your views on that?
Absolutely. So from a person who's sort of coming in as a technology provider, right, I think the fact is, going back to my example, NVIDIA Global Technology Conference, San Jose, AR and VR companies, what are we doing there? And Google had a valid question, what are we doing there, right? Is our data that voluminous that we need GPUs, right? Fact is that what would take us 8 hours to process gets done in 30 minutes, and that's the speed of a GPU, right? Not, it doesn't say that you have the volume of data that probably goes through a computer vision problem, which is lots of images. Big data is about volume of data, but what has changed is the pin 6. you know, Neeraj was talking about the pin stick. That pin stick, in terms of size itself, that it can hold, has changed dramatically. Why has that changed? Because there's more to hold, right? How did we figure that out? Because you had 27 systems in a company that now starts speaking to each other because you have integration layers like MuleSoft, right? And then they start providing you more insight to that one employee that you want to know more about, right? Versus siloed ways of looking at people, because you have a performance application, a comp and ben application, a payroll application, an HRMS system, an ATS system, and whatnot, right? At the end of the day, they all have information across employees that need to combine, and that combined effect gives you big data. Right now, the myriad of information that you can drive from that is another challenge, which we're going to talk about as we go through this panel discussion. But I think the effect of defining that one stick, I think it was a very good example, because that one stick now holds more. It's just the fact, right? And it holds more because now we're starting to look at it as a more complete system of information. And you know, databases, we're talking about NoSQL databases. What does that mean? Right, so essentially it's because we don't look at it in a two-dimensional way anymore, and that really is the evolution of how we look at information, because we want to be able to do the right thing, right? And so we analyze the information faster and from more sources, and hence we have a pool of information that we just can't see the end of. That's the truth.
Siddharth.
So I just have two, excellent points, and you've pretty much covered everything that I wanted to say. I'm just going to add two things. One, of course, is we are starting to see, so big data has a couple of aspects to it. I mean, it's an all-encompassing, it's almost sort of now become a buzzword, you know, big data. I think in general, it's sort of accepted wisdom that big data, for the most part, is unstructured. You know, we're talking about unstructured data coming in from multiple sources, which is why you need a GPU. You need AI, because we're not talking about, you know, third normal form tables, on an SQL database, and you can just run a query. You just train somebody to run a query and get whatever records you need. This data is coming from disparate sources. It's being generated constantly, so there's a stream of it. So there's the streaming aspect of this data that's also, you know, we should be aware of. And organizations are interested in actually making decisions quickly. That's, I think, to me, the three key aspects of what big data is. It's about unstructured, disparate sources, and velocity, as I think we've already mentioned. It's right. The fact that it's actually being streamed. I mean, we're starting out our journey as an IoT vendor. If some of you came into the CXO forum, these tags, recognized you and spoke your name. That's a small little part. But we're just starting out our journey as an IoT vendor. And we've just realized that the volume of data that our simple, you know, IoT devices is generating is about 10x magnitude from the basic data we were generating just about a year ago. Right. So in our own organization, we realized that the diversity and the volume and the velocity of this data is huge. So again, as I've said before, you cannot ignore that big data is here. It's not coming, it's here, whether you like it or not. I mean, your employees are already generating this data. It's up to you on how you want to harness and use it and actualize it and make decisions based on it.
Right. So we've been using a little bit of a technical jargon. I'm sure a few people understand that. And a few people would struggle to understand the technical jargon of unstructured data or non-SQL databases. So what I would request the panelists is to probably talk about what unstructured data is and why is it so important to take decisions around employees, and also give some examples of what really do we mean when we talk about unstructured data.
So yeah, and you know, it's easy for us because we started the premise of the business model. The company is to read a resume and read a job description and mimic the human brain, right? So that's exactly what we were doing with our first customer, Wipro, and saying that we take a bunch of resumes in your applicant tracking system, which you guys have sourced, and we do a demand match to it, right? Then we take one resume and do it to multiple demands. So demand to supply, supply to demand, a resume and a job description. is like the human brain would process unstructured in one sense, right? As much as you talk about structure, that's still natural language. The second part of it is they said, you know what, you're doing a good job on this. Why don't you come inside and do this across the organization? So we said, what does that mean? Said, for the employees, we have 150,000. Why can't you analyze the information there? So we said, you don't need us. You need an SAP system or you need Excel. It's structured information, right? So they said, all right, you don't get this. Come inside, right? And there's a lot of unstructured information. Connect to it, make sense of it, and then use the structured and the unstructured, combine it and match. Right, so then we said, okay, we started looking at the systems, right? You look at performance information, you look at courses and certifications, you look at project experience summaries, work experience summaries, just to name a few, right? And you're starting to analyze information that sits on disparate systems that is housed in an unstructured manner in terms of the form, right? Where you sort of go and pick it from is a different thing, but just the form, right? And that really defines what we mean by unstructured. I mean, going into what a big data architect, for instance, does, I mean, creation of categorized unstructured information like a data lake. Then you'd put a Spark layer on it. Then you'll have a listen and stream layer, right? Then you'll have an API layer. Then you'll have a query engine, right? All of that is beautiful construct to solve that one problem of looking at unstructured information across disparate systems, right? It just opened up a world for us. We built a business model on it, saying, wow, this is a wealth of information, right? Just think about it today. And if we had to do the talent acquisition problem solving, we wouldn't have got enough machine learning information to become so good at solving it on the outside until we looked on the inside. So what's on the inside is so valuable, it's unbelievable, right? And for us, that's the holy grail, to have validated information that sits on disparate systems. And all of you as part of companies have access to that information. And we need to start sort of figuring out methods to drive it to the next level in terms of analysis. So I hope that helps the...
It does. And just for the audience, if the language was still very, very technical in nature, I'd like to basically decodify a little bit. When we capture the engagement data, the engagement scores that we capture for various managers, various employees is a very structured data because it's linked to a unique identifier. But within the engagement data, we also ask employees to provide their feedback on how the organization can improve, which is an open text data. Now, that data doesn't basically link back to either one category, and it's not easily associatable. So to analyze whether it's a positive sentiment, negative sentiment, you need to have those advanced algorithms, which could be natural language processing. No, staying away from any technical jargons here. But yeah, but these are the ones which typically help you decodify data and make sense of that data, which is not linked back to a unique identifier.
Can I just make one quick point?
Absolutely.
I think Arjun made a really good point here, and I want to sort of repeat that just because I think, as you rightly said, we sort of got a little technical there towards the end. Unstructured data is not unstructured because its source is necessarily free text or, you know, the internet or, you know, news feeds from a Facebook. You can actually have unstructured data sitting inside of an SQL database. That's for the last 15 years. I mean, I've had to do cleanups for GIS data. I mean, GIS data is one of the most notoriously unstructured data you could actually get. And it's by definition just two things, it's a lat and a long. But when you start to actually dig a little deeper and look at, okay, you know, this lat long represents this particular tehsil, or, you know, and again, we're dealing with India, where there is no normalization of anything. So any type of data can very quickly become unstructured. What's important is to have the systems in place to deal with those kind of things
properly, right? Just because you have something new and shiny, right? So that's not the answer. The answer is, how do you improve with all the mediums and tools that exist for an employee to engage today, to look at their career progressions, career succession, which is a real thing that we are not addressing, right? How much time does a human being have to address that in the manner that they need to? I think that's really where diving into the data and analyzing it becomes a reality. And breaking it into code and complexities on data structures is another realm, right? Leave it to the technologists.
Right. Absolutely. So
I have a quotient on this.
Sure.
Very unheard of quotient, yeah. So just to continue with the example of engagement, you know, whatever structured or unstructured data you have within, and if you're trying to build in or to deal with the complexity, and if you're getting an outside in data, probably from the Glassdoor or from LinkedIn platforms, and then trying to merge, match, and build those algorithms to throw out the better results, that's probably, you know, a nice way of dealing with real-time unstructured data. I mean, you build the complexity by design and then deal with it. It's probably one thought which I'm getting into it, because I don't have a first-hand experience, but I've heard of somebody doing this and made a slight attempt in the past to present on this. Yeah. So, Neeraj, I think with your permission, there's so much of technical jargons which been thrown around, and just to be a little empathetic to the group here, I thought I'll just quickly pitch in the data which I kind of from my own research. So to take HR analytics to the next level, I think what's required is definitely the competency to do to deal with the HR analytics per se, but nevertheless, if you don't get the right technology, I think competency and technology would definitely take it to a meaningful level. That's my observation, and it was very well recorded with the kind of literature survey I've done. As a part of my study, I've dealt with, interestingly, five parameters, and one of them happened to be about the decision, HR decision making, and improving the business outcomes. So I started with the awareness, you know, how within the community or the fraternity, how has been the awareness about use of HR analytics and its application. The second one was about decision making. Third is about the use of technology and how technology has helped them improve the adoption or implementation. Third is the application of HR analytics in the within the HR function itself. So who are those early adopters in terms of, you know, whether it is talent acquisition or employee engagement, or how are they reading their attritions and stuff like that. Then lastly, it was about the representation part of it, and which you talked about it. So interestingly, I think visualization and storytelling has a remarkable effect of representing the HR analytics data which has been churned thereby. And I think the literature broadly talks about the new two thoughts, and you just can't present the data as it is. You have to necessarily employ a good amount of representation techniques, probably in the form of storytelling and visualization. And I have some examples from, for want of time, I'll just quickly go through the analysis highlights which I had quickly captured. Something I could talk for a day or more, but just in five lines I've captured for it. So as to build in the complexity of the study, I took it from across various managerial levels, across industries, and the size of the organization. So about a little over 100 samples have been managed to collect, few international responses also. So when you talk about awareness of first-hand experience of HR analytics, having the right skill sets or the budgets to support HR analytics practice in an organization, there was a 45 to 60% response were in favor of having the right awareness levels on this, which looked good, but I still feel the tier one organization which largely benefit from an early mover advantage of investing on HR analytics. 78 to 97% of the respondents felt HR analytics aided a better decision making on people policy decisions, and which had its impact on business outcomes. I refrain from making a direct reference to ROI because that's quantifiable data and generally people are not interested in sharing it. 51% of them felt that tech support they don't have the required tech support. So that's 55% of them. And 88% of them felt the need to make a quick, fast buck on this area. Technology can take you the practice to the next level. And no wonder, you know, I mean, there's so many of, of technology offerings to take the HR analytic practice to the next level. 75 to 85% of them felt talent acquisition, employee engagement, and the other management benefits are some of the benefits which probably encouraged them to do process re-engineering and construction of frameworks as a decision impact of the data coming out of their HR analytics. So this is something interesting to note, because apparently, you know, the data has to help you change, take some decisions and help you change something. And lastly, 79% of them felt the presentations in the form of visualization and storytelling had a very good acceptance within the community, within and to the business stakeholders as well. So this is quick summary of the research.
Thank you so much. Thanks, MBS, for sharing these findings. I think some of them are really insightful. MBS, you talked about technology, and something which is being very prominently talked these days is actually the advent of artificial algorithms. Now, HR is one of the areas where, which is basically gearing up to basically using artificial intelligence algorithms. And we would like to hear from panelists some of the examples on where artificial intelligence algorithms are being used for decision making by HR. We'll start with Arjun. I think his entire platform is actually built on an artificial intelligence algorithm, and we'd love to hear his experiences around that.
So artificial intelligence algorithms, especially in the analytics, is about predictive sort of decision analytics, right? So how do you sort of come with probability percentages, right? I'll give you examples based on workforce planning being a solution. It's not productized. We're still diving into how it can hit the levers that can affect, you know, different areas, right? The definition of the problem statement is still where we are. And we were talking about, you know, retrofitting, solutions. People come in with solutions and then sort of fix customers' problems into that solution and say, we've sort of solved it. But I think agility in the new ecosystem that the fraternity requires, right, just from a human resource standpoint, is about understanding what the deep problems are. And maybe that's replicatable, but listening is very important. And in that sense, as we're developing it, you see that creation of demand or ask, yes, I want a big data architect, but is there a big data architect available in Pune, right, within the next 1 month? Or can I get somebody with a near skill? Right? How do I understand that? And just from a skills and experience, I'm not even talking about values and traits and a lot of the other stuff that needs to get in to make sure that you have a cultural fit and the person is clocking and retained in your organization. Ability to understand how you shape that demand better, your ask better, for better fulfillment on time and on cost, starts becoming a reality. And that's one facet of how predictive you can get with, say, a 78% probability changing to a 92% probability. In the internal world, right, we see a lot of the workforce management side being governed by cancellation of demand, overdue demand, marked to external, meaning that I have 150,000 employees, but I still have to hire from the outside. How does that make sense, right? Can I not optimize internally, right? So if you can reduce the level of overdue in some organizations, it's $1 million of revenue a day of lead time that you're missing on, right? If you can reduce that time by giving them the de facto movement, what could you change as a parameters to define demand so supply can fit in and then you can make money, is another aspect of how you can get predictive, right? The third aspect is, we all talk about it, cross skill, reskill, and sort of upskill, right? That's sort of the investment in manage, you know, ethos. But you have companies like Edcast and Degreed out there who are doing great aggregation of content and building learning paths. And again, if you talk to the CEO of Edelweiss, he'll say it's one more application that I have to buy, right? And there's another thing that I have to manage and maintain. But learning and transformation is another area where you can look at how analytics can start delivering better value based on predecessors who have done the job, performed well, and now I can redefine based on my training management system or learning management system what kind of learning path based on content that's been aggregated, like Edcast has 2 million pieces of content. Can I build learning paths that are intuitive? Can I do it according to a skill gap, according to a job definition based on job demand? Can all of that become a reality? And that's analysis of that information that goes into the future. Can it become predictive and then prescriptive, and then sort of people can start relying on it to make decisions that are strategic, tactical, and operational, right? So I think that's really where I come from, and I'm sort of seeing those examples in different avatars across very definite tracks within businesses. You can call it, I've heard blue ocean, deep sky, whatever it is, but it's the new world where we're trying to redefine a more seamless integration of information to start engaging people better, right? And I don't want to define it as an employer or a candidate or a manager, but people better.
Thank you so much. Siddharth,
I've got a few, let's call it experiential nuggets here or 2 cents. I'm a techie, sorry if I get into, mansplaining mode here, but effective, to me, AI today and machine learning are being used somewhat interchangeably. When I think of AI today, I'm thinking really machine learning, because again, we were actually discussing this, just as we were outside. We actually met, I've known Murthy for a year, but we've just met Arjun and myself, and we were talking about how it's the future, and I think all of us in unison said, well, no, it's not the future, it's here. It's already here. I mean, I think we should all agree here that AI machine learning is not something that's coming. It's already around us, right? I mean, all of us have either got an Alexa at home or is using Google, OK Google, to do things like that. And that's just the thin layer or the surface of thousands and millions of hours of machine learning. What we specifically have seen where machine learning starts to become important is even in the most trivial of things, you can start to move some of your data cleanup work, big data, because this is obviously in fact a big data panel. Right. The minute you have big data, unstructured data, you cannot do anything useful at scale without machine learning involved, right? You might be able to create creative ways to do jugaad, but in reality, you need to build structures, machine learning based structures, formal systems to give you useful data. I'll give you 2 small examples. We've been doing field force automation and tracking for our clients for the last 5 years or 6 years. Google's GPS subsystem throws out invalid data at random. If you go on any forum, you'll see that every 30th GPS location or lock that they throw in is wrong. Of course, Uber and Ola have solved this problem. You don't have to worry about it. They've got a bunch of machine learning experts in the background. But any company that's actually looking at using any sort of GIS data at scale is going to have to build in an ML system. So again, my point is just that machine learning and AI are not scary anymore. They're completely democratized. You can actually go on to Google. They've opened up their TensorFlow platform. I'm not saying that you per se have to do this, but it's no longer a super specialized product. It's the way that I feel Android sort of came and became a skill that someone from a tier 3 town can actually pick up over 2 months watching Khan Academy videos. I feel that AI is going to go that way. So don't be afraid, frankly, to try and bring in AI and into your own life for solving mundane problems. It's really all about where there's big data, there's going to be AI requirements, because you're going to need to build AI to clean your data. I mean, before you can do anything with it, you need to clean it. And to clean it, you're going to need AI. That's sort of my point.
Yeah. MBS, would you have any kind of specific examples from HR analytics specifically where organizations would have actually used artificial intelligence algorithms to take their decisions? And was any of such example a part of your study as well?
So yeah, in fact, one of the questionnaire had the AI as a logical extension to the technology practice in place already. So there were very positive response to the extent that practitioners saw that as imminent future. However, we couldn't really capture any, because that was not the intent of the question. It was more about how do they see AI, you know, or machine learning grabbing up the center of. So I have heard of experiences and examples from the past, but honestly, I don't have the data points to, I really don't want to throw it in the wild saying that, okay, this is an X organization which is in there, but I did hear about some scanty examples of AI and ML doing the job for them at a mature level. But however, those organizations which have adopted HR analytics and kind of in the maturity stage, India is fast catching up. That's the observation. Fast catching up, and if you have a good sponsor from the West, there's so many platforms where, okay, just to mention, I think HR analytics today is one amongst every four topics in any of the HR conferences. Absolutely. I mean, absolutely, that's a dipstick which I had done, and I realized. Now, what does it speak is about. You don't have the time to, you know, wait and, you know, assess and then get into it. I think the faster way of doing it probably is to actually sense the confluence of technology into HR analytics, maybe if I put it that way. So you have got this technology which can help you land the HR analytics practice and take it you in a short time to maturity level. So I just wanted to stop at this.
Sure. From my own experience, I can talk about multiple cases on this particular case. Traditionally, organizations have been predicting attrition. Traditionally, organizations have been actually predicting quality of hire. Arjun's network actually does matching of the need for a particular job, a job requirement, to the suitability of the candidate in this particular case, where he uses the artificial intelligence algorithm. And traditionally, since the data sets were not large, a lot of times organizations used to use offline statistical tools to do this kind of analysis. But with the availability of more advanced tools today, organizations are increasingly moving towards using machine learning, artificial intelligence algorithms to basically advance their own methodologies to solve the same set of business problems that they've been solving, let's say, for the last 5-6 years. And with the advancements of technology and with the multitude of data that is being captured to do this kind of analysis, the accuracy in terms of prediction that Arjun was talking about earlier is improving quite tremendously. So that is something which is happening recently, and probably that is where we say that this is where the true confluence between the HR technology and the analytical design is happening.
We're just talking about attrition modeling for an organization which is a sort of a clinical research organization. It's global. In 4 months, we achieved a 90% accuracy in predicting attrition, and the demand supply problem in that industry is through the roof, right? So now we're able to tell them with a 90% accuracy within, you know, 30, 60, 90, 120 days out who are going to leave, right, or what the triggers are. So that's real. That's platinum for these companies, right? Imagine if you had an Alexa or Siri and your voice activating it and said, I wanted 4 big data architects in Hyderabad, right? And it gives you responses, and it comes up on your computer or your mobile device, right? What if Alexa and Siri says that's impossible, you'll never get them in Hyderabad, go to Chennai, right? So that's the real world, and it's going to start transacting into that. It's just voice recognition software translated into natural language, connecting into devices which start using the AI to go and source and check and qualify and do metrics of analysis on internal information to get you the best candidate in 300 milliseconds. right? So that's possible, right? With GPUs and all the good stuff that's out there. But does it make your life easier? Of course it does. Why would you have to listen to people saying, hey, you haven't got me the resource in time. I've been banging on your head. You don't understand what I want. Why would you want to suffer that anymore, right? Get the guy through the door. Get the best person through the door. And I think that's the reality of it. Retain the best people within the organization. Make sure, we were just talking about it. What if you knew that a person is overworked in a specific job? And instead of coming and saying, listen, I know you're working too hard, give him a ticket for him and his family to go out, saying, you know, here you go, take off, versus saying you're overworked. You're sending great messages out to your employees and retention, but how do you know that information unless it comes to you, right? And that's really what we're going to do.
I have one small closing point, just to literally segue from this point. I'm going to tie 2 points here. So one is analytics, and this is actually also topical because of what's happening with Facebook and how they've gotten into trouble. We all know, even though they're here. I hope there's no workplace panelists here. But I'm not going to bash anyone here. But my own small point about analytics and how you've said that analytics is important. From my own experience, I've found that the way to socialize any type of new initiative amongst employees is to really, really say, look, this is your data. Not only is this your data, but any visualization and analytics that we're actually going to use to make decisions about how well you're feeling or your sentiment is actually also going to be available to you. So try as much as you can to be as open about it and transparent about any type of things, because any HR initiative is only as good as how well it's socialized. So we as technology providers like to think that, oh, we've solved the problem. But I think I'm humble enough to now realize that, you know, the problem really only begins after we've met your requirements. You know, the rest, the tough, the X factor in all of this is actually your workforce. And the way to win hearts and minds is actually to say, look, this is your data, we're on your side, we want you to own this data, and we want you to actually be able to, in much the same way as a Fitbit tells you how, you know, you're doing, how many steps you've taken this month. Frankly, the Holy Grail ought to be, you know, this is how your engagement score is this month. You know, is everything okay? I mean, long before your manager comes to you and says, are you feeling okay? Your AI should actually be telling you, hey, you know, I'm noticing that you're actually coming in a little later this week. Is everything okay? So that's sort of where I think, let's not be afraid of technology. It's here. It surrounds us. So.
And as we said in the beginning of the discussion in itself, the technology and the analytics is actually directed towards enhancing the employee experience. So as employees, I think we should be wholeheartedly participating in enabling that. We'll conclude the discussion today. We had so many more points that we wanted to discuss, but because of the paucity of the time, we'll close the discussion today. But before doing that, we'll probably take just 2 questions, if you have anything. Yes, please.
Various data protection laws various countries are adopting. So how it is going to be a future of HR analytics or big data? Just I wanted to know from the panel.
I think you can answer it as much.
I can. Yeah, it's a great question. So I think, yeah, the laws are becoming stricter, and we've seen historically in because the laws were not there earlier, the data at times was actually being misused. So I think HR analytics is going to thrive because the data is increasing on employees, and the technology that captures and analyzing that data is also going to increase. But what it's going to bring in, these entire laws, set of laws, is basically going to bring in a lot of self-checks, as well as a kind of a rule book for the data analytics guys to play with, which we as HR analytics guys feel is a basically a move in the positive direction, because earlier we were operating in the gray. So it's actually a move in the positive direction so that we know where we can actually operate and where we cannot. Yes, please.
You can ask.
Hi.
You can ask your question.
I have a question here for Siddharth and team. So you mentioned.
We'll just take a question.
You mentioned.
Just 1 second.
Yeah.
Just one
okay.
Second.
Fine.
Yeah.
Loud enough. Okay, so my question is, as a user of the technology, what are the couple of things a CHRO can do to build this culture of data-driven decision making. Because you can buy the technology and, you know, use it. Obviously, adoption's always been an issue with technology across the lines. So we've had that problem with CRM as well, with adoption. So what is, you know, what are a couple of things that you did to drive adoption and drive the culture?
Well, I'm in the process of doing it. So the premise I'm working is, when you talk about HR analytics, or for the matter, any of these initiatives, what business case is it solving? So I think for me, it's important to understand, you know, what is that business case which is prominently staring at me, and that's when I can, you know, mix marry my HR data and come out with an analytics platform as a one-time process or on a continuous basis. So for me, which comes up first is the business case, which you need to clearly understand, get your bosses, your stakeholders, define it for you, revisit that. And then my advice would be to start with a POC before you go for a big bang. And that's how you determine. And with just to continue with the last question, I think how much of security you built, the security layer around it while you're doing it, because when you're talking about HR data and you have a data team which is working on it, you have to ensure there's enough of encryption so that, you know, there's no misuse around it. So if you can couple all this, start with business understanding, I think you'll do a good job on landing HR analytics in an organization. Hope I answered to some bit of your satisfaction.
Yeah, that will be
With that, we conclude today's discussion. Thank you so much. Thank you for participating.